Good morning.
Good morning.
May the grace and glory of God be with you today, and what a joy it is to be in worship with all of you on this fine, fine summer day. If you are worshiping with us virtually, we welcome you and glad you are with us this morning. My name is Patrick Schultz. I'm the pastor here, and I want to welcome each and every one of you. Today we begin this new sermon series on the Apostles' Creed. I'm really excited about this. This is a prayer that I've been praying since I was about like that high. Grew up with the prayer, with that prayer. A little bit different wording, but essentially the same. And knew it by heart. And one of my concerns with that is that when I know something by heart, I can pray it without thinking. Now, sometimes that's okay, but I want to spend the summer and early fall taking a look at the Apostles' Creed and what the different parts mean to us, where the Apostles' Creed originated, and what does it mean to us today. So I'm glad you're here for that. In your bulletin are a couple of inserts. We have the hymns. There's two hymns that we're going to be singing today. One is our opening hymn, This Is My Father's World, and then closing hymn, For All the Saints Who From Their Labors Rest. I invite you to keep that handy. When we sing, we'll remain seated while we're singing. We also have a beige card that has the sermon series and a brief introduction to it on the other side. The scripture verses that we'll be doing for each of these parts. We have our GPS, Grow, Praise, Study, and I want to invite you to keep that handy as well. This is additional reading and commentary for the week that are in alignment. It is in alignment with this morning's message. And the back is open intentionally for notes. If you have any questions or thoughts or you want to make a note of them, you can do so on the back and keep this handy throughout the week and take a look at it and read a little bit of the additional scripture each day. At the bottom is a prayer that you can wrap up your scripture reading. We have our welcome card. I invite you to fill this out and drop it in the offering plate at the back of our sanctuary here. And then one other thing I just want to note is that our prayer of confession, if you've looked ahead in the bulletin, you might know this already, but the prayer of confession is the same as the opening prayer. And while it's a very good prayer, I don't know if it merits praying it twice in such a short period of time. So we will ignore what's printed in the bulletin for the prayer of confession. I have a different prayer than all of you. All right. I think that's it, and I do want to welcome Maury Rawlson here, who is our reader this morning, and delighted to have her up here with me. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Lori for a call to worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please stand and join me in our responsive call to worship. Wonderful God, we gather today to celebrate your presence in the lives of faithful people. Send your Spirit to lead us here and guide us into your depths, that we may begin to glimpse your grace. We pray this in the name of Jesus, your
morning, they are the prayer of confession and words of assurance in one prayer. I invite you to listen to this prayer with your heart. God of salvation, we embark this day on a journey that we have made before, a journey that will once again sweep us into unexpected places, always in pursuit of the path of your obedient Son. Send your Holy Spirit to open our lips, that our mouths may declare your praise, and may we be guided on this path of penitence, prayer, and preparation. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Into existence the things that do not exist. In hope, he believed he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words "it was counted to him" were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification.
Self-evident that all men and women are created equal.
four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but rather by the content of their character. These are, in many ways, idyllic expressions of belief when reality is so much more complicated. When prejudice maintains its grip, its grasp on the American people. Where PTSD went untreated for a long, long time. Where the sweet slogans of the mid-70s are just that. Sweet pictures of a simpler life, not the picture of reality with broken families and jobless moms and dads and the struggle to pay bills or working multiple jobs and have no time to go to a baseball game. Bella, in trying to get to the heart of American belief, interviewed many people, and one person was named Sheila, and she had this to say: I believe in God. I can't remember the last time I went to church, but my faith has carried me a long way. There's a disillusionment in the institution of the church that makes it difficult for people to want to be affiliated with the church. The Pew Research Center found that 90%, or in the 90s, 7% of Americans had no religious affiliation, no church connection. In 2009, that was up to 17%. Currently, it's at 26%. A quarter of the Americans polled had no religious affiliation, no church connection. So what does this mean? Rather than listening for and to God's voice, they are listening to a little voice within themselves. So you have on the one hand God's voice, and you have on the other hand our own voice. I think Chuck Colson had it right when he said, when the not so still or small voice of the self becomes the highest priority, religious belief undergoes a change so dramatic that it no longer involves commitment to any authority beyond oneself. The church is no longer regarded as a repository of truth, nor as a source of moral authority, but merely as a place to go for spiritual strokes. And that doesn't leave room for God. It was part of the problem that the earliest Christians encountered as well, early Christianity, as the apostles went out preaching and teaching. A lot of people were being saved of paganism or Judaism, and being saved in the sense of finding their salvation in Jesus Christ. And because the early church had many detractors, attackers, and skewed beliefs, there was a great difficulty in keeping the core teachings core. Early Christians realized that they needed a solid foundational statement of Christ's teaching in some pithy form. Remember, the Bible wasn't available back in those days to everyone. Today, we can just pick up one of our many Bibles and flip through it to read and hear the teachings of Jesus Christ. But thus came about the creed. And the purpose of the creed is not to summarize all of Christian teaching, but rather to undergird certain and unequivocally important parts of Christian doctrine that were under attack and still to this day remain under attack. The creed was also put forth and held in such importance as a way to define Christianity in a sea of religions and superstitions and pagan belief systems. And it emphasizes the universal power of God, creation, incarnation, death and resurrection of Jesus. easily memorize. There's a chronological order that makes sense. Born, suffered, was crucified, dead and buried, descended, rose and ascended, and sits at the right hand and will come again. Very logical order and easy to remember. The Apostles' Creed is to support the Christian doctrine and Christ's church. But not only that. The Creed also helps Christians make a clearer statement of their own faith. With the knowing of the Apostles' Creed, individuals can make clearer statements of what they believe. You either believe that God is, or you believe that God is not. Either way, you're a believer. We can't prove or disprove the existence of God on purely empirical evidence. When you come to an understanding of God's existence, an element of faith comes into it. If I believe that God is, as opposed to believing that God is not, that's going to affect how I live out my life. In my belief that God is, I immediately parted ways with my neighbors who believe that God is not. My life is going to be different from my neighbor's life from that moment on. But Hebrews tells us that those who have been saved will live by faith. Some people have a more doubting Thomas approach. I'll believe it when I see it. The response. They insist that nothing is real if they cannot experience it through their senses of sight, sound, touch.